Well, welcome to our Tuesday evening teaching session. This is session 10, a final session looking at Peter's first letter to what is described as a group of scattered believers. Overarching theme has very much been Peter's desire to encourage and enable a group of believers who are going through a very difficult and troubled time. They're facing persecution. And Peter is trying to set down some principles and some guidelines alongside words of encouragement that will really help them as they face the difficulties of daily life. In our last session, session 9, the focus again that Peter moved in on was suffering. And firstly, he wanted just simply to remind the believers that they weren't to be caught by surprise by the fact that they were facing challenging times. This kind of went with the territory of what it truly meant to follow Jesus. And added to that was this wonderful picture that Peter drew, that as these believers were going through this time of suffering, they were participating in the sufferings of Christ. In other words, not adding to the sufferings of Christ, but it's a process of identification. As Christ suffered, so his followers are suffering. And it's like they're connected together in a very deep and spiritual way. Peter then goes on to draw out some practical reminders. Firstly, that rather than meeting insult with insult, they are to meet insult with blessing. They are to suffer, of course, for doing the right things and not the wrong things. And just that wonderful reminder that they bear the name of Christ. They are, after all, Christians. And that carries responsibility as well as an enormous sense of privilege. And although Peter seems to drift into creating a sense that what they're going through is all part of God's judgment on them, the reverse is actually true. They are caught up in God's righteous judgments by being the victims, and the emphasis is on the being victims of the persecution that is taking place. So it's the persecutors who are bringing themselves under the judgment of God by persecuting the believers. So in that sense, it begins with the household of God. So let's move on to the final chapter, and we're going to cover the whole chapter in this session, and that's 1 Peter chapter 5. Let me begin by reading that for you. To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder, a witness of Christ's sufferings, and one who will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, serving as overseers, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not greedy for money, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him. Stand firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of suffering. And the God of all peace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be power forever and ever. Amen. With the help of Silas, whom I regard as a faithful brother, I have written to you briefly, encouraging you and testifying that this is the true grace of God. Stand fast in it. She who is in Babylon, chosen together with you, sends you her greetings, and so does my son Mark. Greet one another with a kiss of love. Peace to all of you who are in Christ Jesus. So Peter brings this final section of his letter to a close by focusing in on behavior within the church. And at first, he really focuses in on leadership. Churches, no matter what kind of times they are going through, in this case, a very difficult and challenging time, need structure and they need good leadership. And here Peter is identifying one of those key leadership roles within the church, and that, of course, is of eldership. The term eldership, or bishop, or overseer, is very interchangeable within the New Testament. Sometimes they overlap. They more often than not represent and speak of the same particular form of leadership. Somebody with spiritual oversight and pastoral oversight of the church. And of course, this is a role that is to be recognized and authorized by the whole church. How important is the role of leadership at a time when the church is very scattered and going through difficult times? They're facing persecution and they need that sense of good, godly, mature leadership to encourage them. And firstly, Peter, who of course himself was an apostle and one of the most significant of all church leaders at the time, kind of elevates them in the sense that he makes them feel that they are really connected to him. He identifies himself as an elder, as a fellow elder. And it's an encouraging identification that Peter is keen to show them and to encourage them through. They are his fellow elders. They share in the same calling. That same calling to bear witness to Christ, even though times are difficult, to bear witness to the sufferings of Christ through their own sufferings and the way that they respond to them. As a result, they will share in the glory that will be revealed when Christ returns or Christ comes to take them home to be with him. In that sense, they're connected both to the sufferings of Christ and to the subsequent glory of Christ. And of course, integral to the action of suffering for Christ is, of course, a share in his glory. So what kind of role does Peter see these elders within the church fulfilling? Well, Peter makes it very clear they're to act just as Jesus acted. Jesus was the good shepherd who laid down his life for the sake of the flock, as the one who goes before them, the one who leads them to a place of abundance and safety, one who will defend them and secure them a safe place in the future, one indeed who comes searching after them. So the elder is pictured here as both pastor, but also evangelist. They are to be shepherds in the mold of Christ, to model their leadership on the leadership that Christ demonstrated in himself. And of course, Peter had been encouraged by Jesus, particularly towards the end of that time when Jesus was about to return to his Father. Peter was encouraged and challenged to care and protect and to nurture the flock under his care. And so Peter is passing on that mantle to these elders. They are facing difficult times. The believers are scattered and fearful, but more than ever, they need elders who serve as shepherds of the flock, serving faithfully and truly, and seeking to encourage and to bless and to secure a future inheritance for these scattered believers. It's interesting that when Peter talks about the flock, of course, he talks about God's flock. The flock is not theirs. They have responsibilities and they have the privileges of caring for the flock. But the flock very carefully remains God's. And elders are to oversee the flock on God's behalf. And what a wonderful calling that is. And what an amazing responsibility comes with it. So Peter is reminding them that their call is indeed a high calling. And with that comes the call to a higher and better attitude. This role that they've taken on, this role that they have felt God has called them to, the one that Peter is encouraging them is something that they need to do for the right reasons. They shouldn't ever think this is their duty or feel that this is just something that needs to be done. This is an enormous privilege. It's a sacred privilege. It will be challenging. It will require sacrifice and commitment, but primarily it needs to be carried out with a willing spirit. And added to that, Peter points out, this cannot be a role that is motivated by financial gain. It's not about what you can get from this role, but of course what you can give to this role. And so the elders are to serve faithfully and of course joyfully, willingly, counting it an enormous privilege. In the church at the time, and indeed today, people have different callings. And of course, amongst those different callings is the calling to leadership. If that leadership proves to be wise and gentle and is really governed by a Christ-like spirit, it remains a calling that is, in one sense, a calling alongside all other callings. It's not about status, it's not about kudos. It's certainly not about self-indulgence. You serve alongside others but you serve in a particular way, and you serve as a leader, an elder within the church. So I think Peter is pointing out something that is quite obvious. Elders lead by example, not by title. They, together with the brothers and sisters that make up this church, remain under the lordship of Christ. It's Jesus who is the chief shepherd, and it is he they are serving, and they are doing that under the lordship of this great and wonderful shepherd, Jesus. One day, Peter says, you will receive your reward, a reward that will never fade away, a reward that cannot fail. And of course, Peter describes that as the crown of glory. The image very much is rooted in a familiar picture within the Roman world at that time, was that those who were great athletes or successful in the games or in leadership positions, well, they would have a crown. And what Peter is saying, not in a literal sense, is that one day they will share in the crown of glory. Like Moses' face, which reflected the glory of God, well, they will receive that which reflects the glory of God. And they will glow with his glory as their reward for their faithfulness and their determination to see their calling fulfilled. Peter then moves on beyond the eldership group to begin to look at the whole church. How are the believers, the scattered believers, facing a difficult and challenging time? How are they to live together and live as a visible witness of Christ to their community, to their neighbors, to their friends? So as Peter is drawing his letter to a close, he's widening now his perspective. He's looking at each individual member and linking them together and encouraging them to demonstrate certain qualities and attitudes that really truly reflect the Spirit of Christ within the church. And so there's an order to this. Young men are to show respect for the elders, not because they're old, but because their faith has been tested and proved to be right over many years. Peter adds, there's no place for pride or self-elevation within the church. Instead, humility, probably in this context, the word implies modesty, is the mark of faith that they share together. That desire to put others before themselves. If they need exalting, then God will exalt them. They don't have to exalt themselves or expect others to exalt them. It's God in the end who will raise them up. And of course, during their struggles, inevitably, there would be times of anxiety and fear. But they can be confident, Peter tells them, that this is going to come to an end. This isn't going to go on forever. And they can live and even flourish with all of this, knowing that God truly cares for them, and that they can bring all their anxieties and fears to him. God cares about their present suffering, and God will see them through their present suffering. And then towards the end of chapter 5, Peter then moves on to think about the way that these believers are called to overcome the power of darkness. The sense of darkness for these believers, many of them young in the faith, must have been quite overwhelming. the image here is of an accusing attorney at a court, constantly accusation after accusation, pumping, threats and insults and all sorts of accusations, and seeking to almost drive the person into the ground. Well, I think many of the Christians at that time felt that that was what was happening to them. It was a fearful time to be alive, and of course to be a follower of Jesus. And so Peter is saying to them, stay calm, stay alert, be resilient. There's no reason to panic, Peter is saying. Their enemy is strong, but he can be overcome. If they stand firm in their faith, knowing that the terrible things that they are suffering is common to all believers right across the known world at that time, then they will overcome the adversary, the one who is against them, the one who brings these accusations. Peter concludes at this point by assuring them again that their suffering is temporary. They will come through it, and they will share in the glory as they are sharing now in the sufferings of Christ himself. He alone, Jesus, has the final say, and he alone remains forever the ultimate authority. And so the letter closes, as most of the letters in the New Testament do, with what's known as final greetings. Peter, first of all, wants to acknowledge his debt to Silas, who has, it's believed, penned this letter for him. Peter has set out to impart hope in the midst of difficult and troubled times. He sought to remind them of all the rich inheritance and grace that they have received through Christ Jesus, and that this can hold them even through their time of testing. The final reference final greetings is a reference to two faithful servants who stand with them and stand, of course, with Peter himself. The first one is a reference to Babylon. And Babylon in the New Testament and towards the latter stages of the Old Testament had always been a symbol for all that stands opposed to God, and in the New Testament context, to Christ, his Son. Here is probably a reference to Rome. Rome is Babylon. Rome is opposed to all that Christ is. Rome reflects the spirit of Antichrist. And the lady in Babylon is, of course, the church. The church in Rome. And the church in Rome, too, is going through the most challenging and difficult times, and they are standing together with these scattered believers. And the second reference is, of course, to John Mark. John Mark was a faithful friend of Peter's. And although John Mark struggled at points, he also recovered and stood with those who were facing terrible times for the sake of the good news of Jesus. And Mark, John Mark, is standing with the believers here in these provinces, these scattered believers. Peter's greetings are real, and they're very affectionate too. He suggests that they might want to greet one another with a holy kiss. Well, I don't know what you think about that concept, but certainly it's a mark of affection. And there should be that sense of togetherness in the church, that sense of we stand together, not just us, but others are standing alongside us. And also that sense of genuine affection in whatever way that is manifest, in an appropriate way, of course. And then Peter leaves the final word to Jesus. That blessing of peace, the shalom, the wholeness that Christ Jesus offers to us and to them, that we can only find in him. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this journey through 1 Peter. We're probably going to move on to 2 Peter. I think while we're hanging around in this area, we might as well follow on. It's a natural thing to do. But just to say, over the next couple of weeks now, there will be a little bit of a break, and we will let you know exactly when things will return. Maybe after that little break, we can think about having one or two gatherings on site here, so that we can talk together and debate together. That would be a lot of fun. So that's a real possibility. But a couple of weeks, and then we'll be back online with, hopefully, 2 Peter. So thank you very much. If you've made it through all 10 sessions, well done. If you haven't, you can easily catch up if you so desire. So God bless you.
I want Jesus to walk with me. I want Jesus to walk with me. I'm on this pilgrim journey. I want Jesus to walk with me. In my trials, Lord, walk with me. In my trials, Lord, walk with me. While I'm on this pilgrim journey, you know, in my trials, Lord, walk.
Sorrows, Lord, walk with me. In my sorrows, Lord, walk with me.
Walk with me.
While I walk this pilgrim journey, in my sorrows,
yeah.